Hey guys, how's it going? Welcome back to the channel. Today we're talking about Tannoy speakers. And you have no idea how excited I am to talk about a Tannoy speaker on my channel, because Tannoy speakers have been really a big part of my audiophile journey. Yet, I have not reviewed modern Tannoy speakers because I've heard negative things about them and that they're not exactly the same Tannoy speakers that they once were way back. Now, back in the day, my first speakers were the Tannoy Arden speakers and Berkeley speakers and so on. These were big box speakers with one dual concentric driver in the middle. They had spectacular imaging, really great warmth and body to the sound. Yes, not as refined as the modern speakers by today's standards, but they were so musical to my ears and I was really enjoying them at the time. Now, of course, that was the beginning of my journey and I went down the rabbit hole, started collecting drivers from Tannoy, and these are all vintage drivers, by the way, and they had gold drivers, silver drivers, blue drivers, and they had the red drivers. Now, granted, I've owned a lot of the drivers, but the red driver. The red driver was extremely expensive at the time, and even now, it's even more expensive now. And these are all used drivers, and they're extremely expensive. But there's a reason for it. It's because Tannoy speakers were pioneers of dual concentric drivers. So speakers like Kefalos 50, with a tweeter placed in the middle of the mid-bass driver, or lower frequency units, that's what we're talking about. They were the pioneers of that dual concentric design. So today we have the Tannoy XT8F tower floor standing Tannoy speakers. So are these modern Tannoy speakers as good as I remember the old Tannoy speakers to be? And are they still the king of dual concentric designs? That's what we're gonna be talking about today in this video, so make sure to hit that subscribe button and the bell notification so that you don't miss any of these videos, and let's get straight to it. So the main thing about this speaker is going to be the dual concentric design, the drivers. The dual concentric drivers with the tweeter in the middle of the lower frequency unit. That's going to be the main focus with the speaker. That's going to be the strong point, and that's going to be the foundation of what makes this Tannoy speaker so great. So the tweeter in the middle is going to be a linear PEI dome with the outer dual concentric lower frequency unit being a 8-inch multi-fiber paper woofer. The bass driver is also a 8-inch multi-fiber paper pop cone woofer. The speaker's listed frequencies are from 34Hz to 32kHz, negative 6 dB, and it's an 8-ohm speaker with 91 dB in sensitivity at 1 meter. It's a 2.5-way floor-standing loudspeaker with down-firing ports. And it has an omni-magnet structure on the dual concentric driver, allowing the tweeter to basically share the magnet structure with the 8-inch woofer. And what this does is it allows the tweeter unit to be much closer to the mid-range or the mid-bass woofer. And this really makes the coherency better, the point source imaging better, and I can really hear that in this speaker. The point source imaging and the phase coherency is absolutely incredible on this unit. And what do I mean by that in terms of sound? Well, when you hear a track, any track, you hear the imaging dead center. And although speakers these days are very good with being coherent, meaning you don't hear the individual drivers, just having an integrated dual concentric driver like this just takes the coherency to the next level. So definitely you don't hear the individual drivers, you hear it from all from one point source. And that is a huge benefit that this speaker holds, and you can definitely hear it with this speaker, even more so than the very famous KEF LS50 speakers that everyone loves so much. And because of its down-firing ports, it is relatively easy to place these speakers. I didn't find them too hard to place them in my room. I did prefer them a little bit behind where I usually place my speakers, so a little bit closer to the wall for a little bit more full bass response. And I like these speakers with a little bit of toe in, not too much, just a tad bit, and that was perfect for my room, both in balance with imaging and sound staging. Now, these speakers may not be as sensitive to room placement, but they are certainly going to be sensitive to what amplifier you pair them up with. Even though they are 91 dB in sensitivity, which allows you to pair them up with variety of amplifiers for its driving capability, it doesn't mean that it's gonna necessarily sound good or right with multiple different amplification. They are speakers that are quite picky with amplification. But before talking about that, they are in general not the most neutral or the most warm sounding speakers, but they are certainly the one that sounds fun and has excitement and finesse on the top end when required, with that beautiful mid-range coherency and imaging that Tannoy speakers are known to be. The imaging is so great that you can perhaps even draw the performers, and the center imaging is just dead on center, which is just absolutely gorgeous and adds to the musical effect on this speaker. And I think it's safe to say that if you have these speakers, you do have one of the best imaging loudspeakers out there for regardless of the price in the current industry market. And so one of these tracks that I listened to through the speakers, and I think that it represents what these speakers are all about, is One of These Days. And this track has a beautiful vocal with very good guitar strings in the middle of the tracks. And the imaging of the vocals are just spectacular. The voices are recorded with warmth to begin with, so it has that warm nature in the mid-range, which comes through and translate through the speakers. But when you listen to this track, you realize that the warmth in the mid-range is not all that the Tannoy has to offer. There is some excitement in the upper mid-range areas, especially when the guitar strings hit. You hear the excitement and finesse, the openness in the high frequencies. You experience that, and there is definitely some upper mid-range energy and finesse that has some bite to the sound. So it's not just warm and luscious sounding, this speaker actually has some upper mid-range bite and excitement to it. So it's not a boring speaker, it's a pretty fun sounding speaker, and I think this track really represents it very well. However, this is very amp dependent. So I tried mainly three different amplifiers. I tried with the NAD C298 to begin with, and then I tried the Burson's Funk amplifier. This is a 48 watt class AB amplifier that Burson just came out with. And then I tried the tube amplifier, the Wilsonton R800i. And when I say that amplification matters a lot with the speakers, I mean seriously they do. When I play tracks like, for example, Ode to Boy, the live version, it can have tremendous soundstage, beautiful imaging, beautiful articulation with nuances, and just absolutely gorgeous sound with great bass response, full-bodied sound, on the right pairings, while it may sound actually thin, a little bit too bright on the borderline of being really bright, a little bit unrefined, and with lackey, wimpy bass with the wrong pairings. So same track, just way different performance depending on the amplification. So starting off, I tried with the NAD C298, and this was my least favorite combination. And even though this amplifier is technically the most powerful out of the three that I've tested, it had the most underwhelming bass I've heard out of this speaker. The bass was very underwhelming. Yes, it was fast, clean in the mid-bass region, but the extension was just not there. The upper mid-range had some sparkle and some excitement, but it was just a tad bit too bright for my liking. So on a track like When Did You Leave Heaven, for example, The vocals are dead center. It's just beautiful, very clear sounding. But then the vocals sometimes gets a little bit too hot for my liking and piercing. And I don't imagine myself hearing this track over and over again with this speaker for a very lengthy period of time. It's gonna get pretty fatiguing pretty fast with this pairing. And this track has some warmth to the sound, but it was gone with the NADC-298 pairing. Now, when I paired it with the Burson Funk amplifier, 48 watts per channel, class AB, it really brought that warmth and body back to the sound. So not only was I getting dead center imaging and vocal that was just gorgeous, and with a little bit of rounded off vocal ranges that just was perfect, and not too much excitement, not too little excitement, I think it was just perfect for this track, while the warmth was still there to accommodate that musical experience and smoothness in the mid-range. So the Burson Funk really changes how I heard this track with these speakers. Now, don't get me wrong, the Burson still has that upper mid-range sparkle. It's not totally gone. It's just less than the C298, which allows it to be more bearing, at least for my liking, while still having that great bass authority, more so than the NADC-298 ever did. So the bass authority really surprised me with the Burson Funk and the Tannoy pairing. So when, for example, when I was listening to Lover's Rock by Sade, this was a track that was now bearable with the Burson Funk and was not with the NADC-298 pairing. Way more bassier and full-bodied sounding with smoothness that was just right for me with the track that I was listening to. Now with other tracks, I wanted a little bit more smoothness, so I paired up with the Wilsonton R800i tube integrated amplifier. This is a heavy beast. It has 805 tubes in it with a lot of different tubes that I've been playing around with, but this is a great single-ended tube amplifier, and I think this is where the matching really shines with Tannoy speakers. Now granted, the bass didn't seem as tight or clean sounding as the Burson, but it certainly had more warmth and weight to the sound, and it was just a more enjoyable musical experience even in the bass region. Now, a track that really comes to mind is Forget Me Nots, and this track was unbearable with the other two pairings. Even with the Burson, it was just a tad bit shrill on the upper mid-range area. It was a little bit, just a little bit too unbearable to listen to the entire track. Now with the R800i, it was very apparent that it was tamed down. The upper mid-range had still had that shimmer, sparkle, whatever you want to call it. It was still there, but it was there with so much beauty. It was a certain type of beauty that was just a little bit of sparkle sweetness instead of the one that I was hearing with the Burson and the NADC-298, where it was a little bit too piercing for my ears at times. This was entirely different. This was sweetness that I heard, not so much a upper mid-range forwardness, if you so will. Now, in terms of sound staging and the overall presentation of the speaker, where it really shines is, I think, tracks like Dazzle Ships. And this type of track that is live is really, really nice because it gives you a spacious information, and this speaker really translates that very well. It has an articulate presentation in the upper mid-range, so the vocals are extremely clear and crisp, wide soundstage, deep soundstage, and you get that three-dimensional sound with with certain tracks having soundstage all over you. Now, however, this is not with most tracks. You know, with most live tracks, however, it does this beautiful soundstaging, and I really like live tracks with this speaker. However, with certain music that I've mentioned so far, it didn't really have the largest soundstage out of the speakers that I've reviewed so far. It was about average in soundstaging. But certainly, soundstaging is certainly one of the strong points with this speaker in my mind, especially with live recordings, if you enjoy that. Now, one track that I really liked, even though it was not a live recording, and this is just to say that it's not just live recordings all the time, was Water from a Vine Leaf. And this track really, really sounded amazing. Three-dimensional. I heard things here and here instead of just in front of me, but surrounding me in 3D type of way. of sound staging. It was just a miraculous experience, and I absolutely love that. Now, that's pretty much it in terms of its sound that I can really grasp. Like I said, the imaging and the coherency of the dual concentric design is to die for, especially in the mid-range areas and the vocal ranges. So if imaging is important for you and if that's your first priority, this speaker really hits the sweet spot, and you can safely say it's one of the best in terms of that kind of way. So that's it from me. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video and if this video was helpful to you, consider subscribing and giving us a thumbs up. And also consider supporting us on our Patreon to keep us independent and keep these honest videos and reviews coming. Until next time.